Penguin Random House Audio presents Shooting Ghosts, a U.S. Marine, a combat photographer, and their journey back from war. By Thomas J. Brennan, USMC Retired, and Finbarr O'Reilly. Read for you by David H. Lawrence XVII and Mike Chamberlain. "It makes no difference what men think of war," said the judge. "War endures. As well, ask men what they think of stone. War was always here. Before man was, war waited for him. The ultimate trade awaiting its ultimate practitioner. That is the way it was and will be. That way, and not some other way." Cormac McCarthy, Blood Meridian. Prologue. An Odd Alliance. Friendship is born at that moment when one person says to another, "What? You too? I thought I was the only one." C.S. Lewis, The Four Loves. Finbarr, Nabu Aga, Helmand Province, Southern Afghanistan, November 1st, 2010. An explosion. The shockwave kicks through my chest. Then, silence. A moment of calm as the battle holds still in that instant before everything changes. Dust hangs in the air. Two Marines are down, motionless. Then, another bolts toward them through the haze of confusion. There's shouting and shooting. The spell is broken. Time resumes, sprints forward. They move, I move. My shutter clicks, recording the aftermath of a blast that will weld my life to that of an injured Marine, Sergeant Thomas James Brennan, leader of 3rd Platoon, 4th Squad, Able Company, 1st Battalion, 8th Marines. The emotional impact of the explosion reverberates across continents. A few hours later, Sergeant Brennan's mother, Karen, is at Boston Children's Hospital, where she works as a radiology assessment nurse. Karen's husband, Jim, sends her an email with a web link that automatically updates my photos as I file them from Afghanistan. He often does this so they can keep tabs on their 24-year-old son, whom they both call TJ. Between the time Jim sends the message and the time Karen clicks on the refreshed link, photos of TJ lying limp in the dirt have been added to the newsfeed. Karen recoils from her desk when the images pop up on her screen. She can't read the captions. All she can see is her son's pale, blank face. She pitches forward and drops her head between her knees. Three co-workers rush over to ask what's wrong. Karen gestures at the screen while hyperventilating. "I don't know if he's alive or dead," she says. One of her co-workers, who is also from a military family, reads the photo caption and tells Karen that TJ has been injured by an explosion, but that he's alive. Karen asks the nurse to close the computer. Then, she weeps. Finbarr, Boston, October 2012. 2 years later, TJ and I sit side by side in a silver sedan, cruising down an open highway as strip malls and autumn scenery slide by. It's a Saturday afternoon in late October, and we're in Massachusetts on our way to his parents' house in Randolph, a suburban town with wide, curving roads and large houses set among trees. We are 6,500 miles from where we first met. The last time we sat together was 19 months ago in Afghanistan. Much has changed. Over there, he was the leader of 14 U.S. Marines and one Navy corpsman, deployed to Helmand Province. I was a photojournalist embedded with his unit. We were leaner back then, our bodies tapered by the demands of our jobs. No matter how many high-calorie ration packs we consumed, the weight still melted from our bodies on long foot patrols under the burden of heavy gear and brutal heat. Now, we're both living in the United States, far from the conflicts that have marked our lives, and within striking distance of countless fast food joints. I'm no longer carrying my cameras everywhere, and he's no longer armed with a rifle. Our individual journeys from Afghanistan to here have not been easy, but we've leaned on each other in unexpected ways. The skepticism and even hostility we first felt toward each other have grown into trust. War tears people apart, but it also flings them together. Through the unpredictability of war and its aftermath, Sergeant Brennan and I became friends. Like most people who know him well, I call him TJ. He calls me Finn. We forged an unlikely bond patrolling together through the dusty alleyways of Helmand Province and camping side by side for weeks in the desert. That bond only deepened after TJ was injured during that Taliban ambush, and then later after we both returned from Afghanistan. When TJ began to suffer from the effects of his injury and from the painful memories of his tours in Iraq and Afghanistan, he told me about his struggles. They sounded familiar. People rarely consider it, but war correspondents experience similar rates of post-traumatic stress as combat veterans. The causes can be different, but guilt plays a prominent role for both. For TJ, it's the things he's done or didn't do that haunt him. My own conscience is nagged by the fact that I am paid to photograph people at their most vulnerable, while I'm able to do little to help. I photographed TJ moments after he was injured and nearly killed. Now, our friendship offers us both a shot at redemption. TJ sought my help as he confronted his altered reality. Collaborating with him restored something within me at a time when I was confronting my own struggles in the wake of war. It took getting to know each other for us to understand what trauma means, what it does to those who live with it, and how to cope. We are still learning. Our perspectives on war differ. I'm a witness, and TJ is a participant. But like TJ and many other young men, I was drawn to conflict zones. TJ had his own reasons, including the belief that his Marine dress blues would get him laid, whereas I saw the intensity of combat as an ancient rite of passage into manhood, a measure of my worth, yes, sure, as a way to impress women. He may have known a little about what he was getting into, but I was ignorant of what the journey might cost. TJ and I now embody the stereotypes of the broken military veteran and the damaged war journalist. But such labels, while true, hardly tell the whole story and serve little purpose. Neither of us is a victim. We both chose to go to war. We seek no sympathy or pity. What we're trying to figure out now is how we can lead purposeful lives after experiencing the sense of loss and meaninglessness wrought by war. The last thing we want to do is perpetuate the myth of the trauma hero. Every true war story is a story of trauma and recovery, author and Iraq War veteran Roy Scranton wrote in a 2015 article for the Los Angeles Review of Books. A boy goes to war, his head full of romantic visions of glory, courage, and sacrifice, his heart yearning to achieve heroic deeds. But on the field of battle, he finds only death and horror. He sees, suffers, and causes brutal and brutalizing violence. Such violence wounds the soldier's very soul. Afterward, upon returning home, Scranton writes, the boy, now a man and a veteran, is haunted and unable to make sense of his memory, whereas most people don't want to know about the awful truths of war. The political powers want to sanitize its horrors, and anyone who wasn't there can't understand what it was like. The truth of war, the veteran comes to learn, is a truth beyond words, a truth that can be known only by having been there, an unspeakable truth he must bear for society. So goes the myth of the trauma hero. Focusing solely on the psychological trauma American service members have endured allows us to forget the death and destruction they are responsible for, Scranton warns. Or, as the Scottish comedian Frankie Boyle puts it, Not only will America go to your country and kill all your people, but they'll come back 20 years later and make a movie about how killing your people made their soldiers feel sad. The joke cuts deep for the bitter truth it reflects. America's interventions in Iraq and Afghanistan have been disastrous and costly, both in human and financial terms. Iraq and Afghanistan are even more divided than before. The region is in a state of chaos, and the resulting instability has spilled into Europe and caused a backlash at home. So, why risk excusing the aggressors? Because this isn't a book about American foreign policy, or those who make the decision to go to war, or who is the true aggressor. It's about one low-ranking individual who carried out his nation's order to fight and is forced to live with the consequences.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.